I'm a robot, not a witch.
But you are dressed as one.
They rip me up like this. And this isn't my nose, it's a false one.
Well, what would you do the nose?
The nose?
And the hat. But you're a witch.
Did you kiss her?
No.
Yes.
A bit.
She has got a wart.
What made you think she...
Well, she turned me into a newt.
Cream on the one. So what that displays is the scientific method. Not, right? It hasn't been invented yet. That's another one of the things that Descartes invents, is a method. So that's kind of intriguing. But the Inquisition was what I was talking about. And you know, if you think about it, prior to the church sending educated cardinals or monks of high rank to villages to adjudicate these kinds of conflicts that were going on in the villages, that was the kind of jury that people ended up with. It was basically everybody who was mad at somebody else would pretty much fight. You know, basically, you know, that was how God would judge who was right. You know, basically, might would make right. So when you read some of the trials which are available, by the way, even the Salem witch trials, by the way, are kind of fascinating. If you read those, you end up seeing that there was actually a level of judiciary interest that was definitely an improvement. So we might not, I'm not suggesting that the Inquisition was something we should go back to that, you know, no. You know, the point though is that it's an improvement, even if you're looking at how horrible the Inquisition was. They kept records. They actually had a trial. They did believe that, you know, you could get a confession out of someone by breaking their arm, you know, putting them on the wheel. You know, you're familiar with the wheel of Fortuna, right? You know, which broke your bones, you know, and you know, you're suffering like crazy, and confessing, and well, they confessed, and they really thought apparently that way, but still, the argument is that there's a slight improvement in doing that. And by the way, Martin Luther's most famous quote, I think. When there were wars among the members who were claiming to be Lutheran and those that were Catholic, literally ended up saying, "Kill them all, and let God sort them out." Now that would be, you know, and they also referred to him as the Lutheran Pope and things of that sort, because. His idea at first was, you know, you should have open critical thinking of these religious beliefs, which is actually something Aquinas recommended, right? But in opening, you know, things to critical thinking, he had no intention of saying, and you could think critically too. No, he says, I'm going to think critically, and you have to believe me. So it wasn't like he was suggesting everybody gets to think for themselves. Not at all. It was just that he was the one that was going to dictate and not the Pope, etc. So, very interesting, but you ended up with a Lutheran church which they were anti-icons or iconoclasts. And so one of the things they did was they destroyed the art in the churches and whitewashed the walls and things, so they did away with a lot of fantastic medieval art and statues and things, and the crucifix went away and became a cross, because the body on the cross, which makes it a crucifix, was art, and you were giving an image of a person, and in a sense is very similar to the Islamic art that shied away from images. It's kind of interesting, an awful lot of, still today, you see praying hands was an image that was okay. Oddly, as we get to the period where Bach is asked to be a composer in Dresden, which was a Lutheran church at the time, they asked Bach to write music. They wanted it to be very conservative music, because they were very much against too much pleasure being part of the music of the church, because they were still interested in that. And yet you ended up with such incredibly rich, sensuous music, starting with Bach and others, that a church that on the one hand is against the sensuosity of the art on the walls and the statues, at the same time moved in the direction of music, where you're having instruments in the music, as well as the voices, and the church is, you know, the Roman Catholic Church is still just voices, no instrumentation. Yes.
Were they not a fan of devil notes then?
You know, I don't know how many people were aware of the devil's octave, and how that could be used, and it got clearly snuck in more and more because people weren't aware of it. I think.
So much of their kind of music
as
it.
Yeah.
It was banned in a lot of churches.
Yeah, that's like around this time period too.
I'm not 100% sure. I know Mozart used it in his plays and operas, so this was a little bit before him. So I'm not sure if he was inspired by
that or not.
Like, he definitely knew it. I think he was, you know, having a lot of fun with what he could do and get away with. So the method, and when we think of Descartes' method, we think of the way Euclid really wrote his Elements. Are you familiar with Euclid's Elements? I didn't really touch on that at all, but I should mention Euclid, because now it's going to come back. But this is kind of amazing, because thanks to Euclid, you end up with. I should actually just go to the Elements. But it's really the invention of monads, atoms, the point. Let's do. Definition. So the definitions, this is Euclid, obviously in English. A point is that which has no part. This is a mathematical point, has no part. So if you think of that, okay, how does that work? Circle has points.
A circle is defined by points.
Yeah. But so a point has no parts. This is Plato, really. Remember, if it's an idea or spiritual or our mind has, our soul has no parts. Therefore, it can't be created or destroyed, because in order to create something, you have to take parts and put them together, and you destroy it, you take the parts apart. So the argument that we get from Plato about the soul being eternal, and remember that changes with Augustine, because there's no eternity there, it's instead created still. No explanation how that works, right? Because you still get the same idea that it has no parts, right? But in the case of Euclid, a point has no parts, which, remember, I gave you the argument about my sloppy triangle up here saying it wasn't two-dimensional, it's three-dimensional, because if you look close enough, you can see it has depth to it. And a real line has only the points, and the points have no parts, so there's actually no physical line. If you end up with a line on the board, that's a metaphor for a line, but a true line is made up of points that have no parts. Breathless length is a line, ends of a line are points, etc., etc., etc. And once you do the definitions, right, then you can move on. Well, you also have the axioms, and I skipped the axioms, but you end up then with postulates, to draw a straight line from any point, et cetera, et cetera.
I'm pretty sure the postulates are the same as the axioms. Are they? The axioms.
That's because, oh, yeah, okay, because we don't have axioms listed there. Okay, good. But you get the idea. You need step by step, and then you get to your propositions, so that now when I'm reading the proposition, I can explain that the proposition is true because of a reference to the definitions or the axioms or whatever, right? So that's basically the method that Descartes is now going to give us, and you could see that if we go to Descartes. Oh, you don't want. Method. And so he's trying to create a method by which science will work, where you can start off with something that you know for sure and build on that, right? And you'll have knowledge that is secure knowledge. Well, this is where he also goes into his method of doubt, or the Cartesian doubt. Did I get lost? Maybe. I can go back to here. But he's got the Discourse on the Method, and by the way, that is the book where you actually will find Cogito Ergo Sum, or I think, therefore I am. That's where you'll find that. But the more famous book that most people read are the Meditations. And the Meditations is where he establishes the security of that first principle, or the first thing that you really know for sure. And what he has to do is establish that